ladies and gentlemen, this morning we've come to a part of our lecture where it's incredibly exciting because we're going to have a look at movement this morning. Movement is life. Strength comes by exercise, and activity is the very condition of life. Stagnant pools breed disease, and stagnant bodies breed disease. And we've come to a time in Earth's history where people don't actually need to move that much because we've got cars and buses and trains and planes and vacuum cleaners and automatic washing machines, and people don't even use elbow grease to wash the showers now. They just use sharp chemicals. And because activity is not a necessary part of most people's lives, many people are getting sick because their bodies are not moving. A couple of times this week, I've referred to the blood as the river of life. It is the river of life because wherever the blood touches, it brings life. It brings nutrition. It brings water. It brings oxygen. And it takes away waste from every single part of the human body to every absolute extremity. One of the problems is when the body's not moving as it should, that river of life doesn't reach the extremities quite like it should. I'm amazed at the amount of people, even young people, tell me they always got cold feet. What does cold feet mean? There's no river of life down there because the river of life is warm. So any part of the body that's cold, it's an indication the river of life's not getting there. And if the river of life is not getting there, death can start to happen in those parts of the body. Early in the week, we looked at the kidneys. And we looked at how many people are experiencing cold kidneys because they're not wearing enough clothing in that area. That's when those little nephrons start to die because the river of life is not reaching them. And you know what the farmer does with the little lamb? He puts a little ring, a little tight ring around the top of the tail. And it takes, I think, a couple of weeks and the tail falls off. Why does the tail fall off? There's no river of life in the tail anymore. And you talk to any farmer, they say it might sound cruel, but it's actually very kind, because out in the paddocks, when the rain comes, and it can get moist under that tail, and maggots can get in and even start eating away parts of the sheep. So losing the little tail is actually a kind act, especially when you've got thousands of sheep. But my illustration is to show you the importance of that river of life. So anything that you can do to ensure a proper delivery of the river of life to every single part of your body means healing to that part of the body, because the blood is the healer. And perfect health requires perfect circulation. Perfect circulation means my toes are as warm as every other part of my body. But what usually happens in the night when you're sleeping, everything slows down a little bit, and we're glad, because as we slow down, that's when the body starts to revive and recharge. But the river of life slows down to a nice quiet pace. So when you wake up in the morning, the blood tends to have pooled in the internal organs. And the best time to exercise is in the morning, because it brings that blood right out to the extremities and basically sets up a pace for your body to run at all through the day. So even if you're going to be sitting most of the day, the fact that you've done an early morning workout means you've actually raised the rate. You've set a pace that the body will run at through the day. For exercise to be a powerful healing remedy, it must be done in the morning and it must be done regularly. This is called frequency. Frequency means done frequently. God designed that this living machinery be in daily activity, and in that activity is its preserving power. For exercise to be a preservative, it must be done frequently. All the experts agree, you won't hear me say that much, but they do agree on one thing. Half an hour's exercise a day will keep the body in good working order. That's your maintenance program. Have you ever seen a house that hasn't been maintained? When we came into this health retreat here, It was not a health retreat when we came to it. In fact, the first time we walked into this building, I thought it looked like a sickness retreat. It had not been maintained. All the draining areas were all blocked up. In fact, Michael chipped back the grass one day and he kept chipping and he kept chipping at the back, and he chipped back a full foot and he found a drain. And in the drain was an old boot and some old clothes. And because the drain hadn't been maintained, the water was all coming in. And there was a lot of mold in this place. When I came here, I thought, how could this ever be converted into a health retreat? It had had no maintenance program. Takes a lot of work to build a house, but not a lot to maintain it. Well, we came in and there'd been no maintenance. And it took 6 months of a lot of workers to get this once again up to operating standards. It hadn't been maintained. We're maintaining it now. I meet so many bodies that haven't been maintained. Haven't been maintained. And some people say, can you get me fixed in a week? I said, whew, the body's an amazing piece of machinery, but whoa, that's a tall order, a week. How long since you've exercised? Oh, 20 years. Do you know, with many human bodies, it takes 20 years of not treating it right before it breaks down quite badly. Well, I've got some good news. It's not going to take 20 years to get it better again. Did you catch that one? Won't take 20 years, might take two. Take a month for every year you've done it wrong. It's not year for year, that's the good news. We couldn't get this place ready in a week. It took 6 months of very hard work. And this is not a living machinery. Your body's a living machinery. And the miracle of the human body is what some bodies survive considering the conditions they've been given. But because the blood is the healer, anything that stimulates the blood moving a little bit faster is square one, paramount. Half an hour's exercise a day will keep the body in good working order. That's your maintenance dose. 1 hour's exercise a day will reverse major problems. What sort of problems? You name it. Start at the tip of your toe and go up to the tip of your head. And any problems in any area of the body, take a 1 hour exercise a day to get a reversal of major problems. Did you hear about the old Aussie farmer? Happened about 30 years ago. Michael said it was in the news again recently. Been given 6 months to live. I think he was in his late 60s. He had cancer. In his distress, he just put a few belongings into a wheelbarrow and decided to walk. He's going to walk around Australia. And he walked and he walked and he walked. It took him 2 years. How long did he have to live? 6 months. When he got back, he felt fantastic. He felt vibrant. His body was not walking like this anymore. It was almost sprinting. And the energy that it took to sprint was less than the energy when he first started out just to walk. Amazing things happen in the body when you start to move it. He saw his wife and he thought, who's this old lady? He was tested, no cancer. Wow, that's cheap medicine, isn't it? One guy said to me, you want to be careful when this gets out, Barbara, there'll be a traffic jam of wheelbarrows. If only. It's one of the cheapest remedies there is. How many hours in a day? 24. It's not much, is it? It's not much at all. I used to think that I didn't need an exercise program because I was busy all day. I'm gardening, I'm running here, doing this. I had 6 kids and then 8 kids. Always busy. And it was about 10 years ago, I was asked to go to New Zealand to do a series of lectures. The girl I was staying with, it was out in the country a little bit, she's about 10 years younger than me. She's twice my size. I'm about 48, 50 kilos. She's about 100 kilos. And in the morning, actually before I went to bed, she said, I do a 5K work in the morning. She said, do you want to join me? And I said, love to. I don't have to get the children up and put the washing on and put the breakfast on and all the things that you do when you've got lots of children. So went on our morning walk. First kilometer was great. Started to come to some hills. I could not keep up with her. I felt very silly. I'm the health teacher. I couldn't keep up with her. And she's carrying 50 kilos that I'm not carrying. And I couldn't keep up with her. It was very embarrassing. I had to stop talking, breathing like this. Next day I woke up. Oh, oh, she said, want to come this morning? I said, fine. Oh, she had a friend with her this morning. They just were a long way ahead of me. I was struggling, but I just kept going. When I went home, I thought to myself, lesson taken, lesson learnt. I'm going to exercise. Now, how I had to do it was I had to go to bed a little bit earlier. And how do you go to bed a little bit earlier? Well, you don't eat an evening meal. And how do you get away with not eating an evening meal? Well, you have a big lunch and you have a little bit of breakfast. Well, a bigger breakfast, I should say. Can you see where you start? For today, for the running of today, you have to start yesterday. And tomorrow I'm going to show you what part of the brain does that. It's the frontal lobe. That's foresight. You have to start the day before. And so I had to walk at 5:30. It's the only way I could fit it in. 5:30 to 6, woke all the kids at 6. It was great. I got the breakfast on and just put it on a very low heat. So in Melbourne, I had to walk in the dark. I read this in an old book. In a short while, you will so experience the benefits of pure air and exercise, you would not live without these blessings. Wow, can you see why I memorized it? Just love it. It's actually one of my favorite parts of the day. I'll look forward to it with excitement. Because when I get back, whoa! A friend of mine, young girl, recently told me this. She told me this last week. She said she was going out with a guy. They were having, you know, really enjoying each other's company. And then he said, look, I want a bit of space. And he broke it off. She was devastated. She said to me, I'd go to bed crying. I'd wake up crying. I'd have a shower crying. And I thought, I've got to do something. So she put her joggers on and went for a run, 5K run. Halfway through the run, she's feeling so good. You see, feelings went back a bit and decision part of the brain kicked in. And she said, what am I doing? And she could not understand how, at that point, that she was crying all the time because another part of her brain had kicked in. She got back, gave a little shake and thought, get on with life. It totally changed the way she thought by doing that 5K run. So she started to do it every day. Got slim, got fit, started to smile more. Well, guess what? They're back together again now. In other words, if you're sad, if you're depressed, if you're discouraged, if you're overwhelmed, what do? Put your joggers on and go for a walk. Dr. Neil Nedley, in his book, Depression, A Way Out, if he gets very severely depressed people, bipolar, schizophrenia, he puts them on 7 hours of exercise a day. 7 hours of exercise a day. This isn't 7 hours of aerobic. The guy that walked around Australia, I'm sure at first the pace was like this. You just start where you are. Maybe the person walks around the village and then walks around the village again, stops for lunch, stops for a drink, just keeps moving. He said after 7 days, these people are so improved they can go to a 1 hour a day maintenance dose. That's 7 days of 7 hours exercise a day. Now, when you look at how this guy conquered his cancer, is that a treatment for actually every single thing that happens? He says, restless legs, exercise. You name it, he says, exercise has to be an integral part of a recovery program and an integral part of a maintenance program. What type of exercise? By the way, before I move on to the type, that 1 hour a day, that can be 2 half-hour spots or a half-hour spot and a 2 15-minute spots. But there must be at least a half-hour chunk in that day. By the way, my husband watched me exercise for 3 years and then he joined me. I never said a word. Never nag, because it never does any good. Do you know, when you go home, you're going to be so excited about how you feel and what you've learned, you're going to want to share. But the only thing you can really share is what you do. You've just got to bite your lip and smile. What are you smiling about? I just feel so good. Why do you feel so good? Oh, well, actually, I've just come back from... You actually can only speak when you're asked. It's like we used to have all the staff eat at our table in our health retreat in Melbourne. And one day this guy came to me and he said, look, can you talk to my mum, who also was our cleaning lady and sat at the table, can you talk to my mum about what to eat to lose weight? Because, you know, she's putting on too much weight. I said, I'm not going to talk to her. He said, why not? I said, because I have no right to talk to her. Now, if she comes to me and says, can you help me with weight loss? Aha, we can talk. But until that time, I cannot. I said, I want people to feel comfortable at my table. He was a bit upset with me. I said, so be it. 2 weeks later, his mother came to me. Can you help me with weight loss? I said, sure. Do you know what I used to say to them? You watch the slim girl at the table. Watch what she eats. Watch when she gets up and leaves the table. And watch where she is at 6:30 in the morning. She's out there walking. There is a formula. If you abide by the formula, it works. Intensity. Intensity is the other part of the formula. This is no gentle stroll. This is hard work. And I think when the farmer with the wheelbarrow came to the hill, there's a bit of hard work there, wasn't there? But notice when you're cycling, notice when you're walking, there are periods of intensity and periods of rest. And the rest is just as important as the intensity. You could call the rest recovery. Rest doesn't mean stopping. Rest means giving the part of your body that you're working out a recovery time. And when you go to the gym, you probably notice there's circuits, because this exercise will work the quads. And then when the quads are starting to scream at you, give me a break, then you'll go on to maybe another one where the quads will get a break and maybe you're doing push-ups on that one. So the quads are getting recovery time. And you'll find cycling, you do it because you're up the hill and then you've got your recovery downhill. You look at children in a playgroom. What do you see? Dart here, running over there, stopping for a little bit, running over here. Have you ever watched them? You watch children, they've got periods of going for it, periods of recovering. Now, they're not choosing that recovery time, that's just what they do. Always watch the kids. How do the kids breathe? With their abdominal muscles. By the way, how do they run? On their toes. I've got a friend who's a runner and he said, I was taught to run like this, you know, heel up. He said, you know what they're saying now? Oh, sorry, that was wrong. You got to run like the children do. Watch how you run on your toes. Just watch the kids, the way they naturally do it. That's the way to do it. So what is this intensity? It's called interval training. Have you heard of interval training? It was probably in about the 90s, I think. There was a Japanese trainer who got his girls, I think it was figure skating, ready for the Olympic Games. He got them to an incredible fitness and he did it by this interval training. And what it is, you absolutely go for it for 30 seconds. That's not long, is it? It is when you're going for it. That's all it takes is 30 seconds. Absolutely going for it. And how many people, when the heart rate starts and the respiration increases, they back off? How many people, when they're going up the hill, back off a little bit? Nah, you push yourself up the hill, and when you're going down the hill, that's when you can back off a little bit. It's this interval training. And depending on your fitness, depends how many 30-second blasts you can put in. Half an hour's exercise a day, putting in a 30-second blast, that's not much, is it? That's not much to ask, is it? If there's no hills, you might jump down on the ground and do some 30 seconds push-ups. You tried 30 seconds push-ups, a lot of time push-ups. Can't get down on the ground, do it on a tree. I think everyone can do this. Push-ups on the side. It's actually intensity. You've seen really obese people, 150 kilo, really large. They've done studies on these huge people, and they presume their muscles will be very strong because the muscles are holding all of that weight. But the opposite's true. They found that the muscles are thin and weak and sometimes paper thin in the back here. And this was a real puzzle. It's all to do with the way the body runs. Because the muscles aren't being called into use because the person's not moving, and why don't they move? Because it's too hard, because they're carrying so much weight, and the knees start to crack. Did you know that? Under the weight, the knees start to crack. And they go on their ankles, the ankles start to crack. And so they, you know, it's too hard to exercise. And what happens when they eat, and how many of them are eating, how many Aussies are eating high carb? It all goes to fat. It all goes to fat. And the muscles almost start to sleep, and the muscles start to break down because it's very expensive muscle. Running machinery is the muscle, so it starts to break down. And so what they have found, same as this Japanese trainer found, if you can do a 30 seconds intensity, what it does is it gets inroads of blood into those muscles, wakes them up, gives them a shock, gives them such a shock, they tear. These are called little micro tears. But when the micro tears happen, then the body needs more fuel. And so the person starts to eat more. They're not putting on weight. The fuel's going to the muscles, and the muscles start building, getting stronger and stronger and stronger. It's basically the same as waking the muscles up. What wakes the muscles up is this. You've got to do this intensity. Now, this intensity can change depending on your fitness. Michael and I have been doing it. Well, we always do it when we get a hill. And what we've started to do now, when we get to the hill, we start jogging. We start jogging up the hill. 30 seconds isn't long. Yes, it is a long time when you're absolutely going for it. And your body will start screaming at you, "Give me a break." Quiet. It's only 30 seconds. And of course, that will change depending on the person. For someone who's not fit, carrying a bit of extra weight, that just might be a walk up the hill. But if a person isn't carrying extra weight and a lot fitter, it might be running for your life up the hill. So you actually gauge it as to where you are. And the beauty on your morning walk, when there's a whole heap of you, you might have different people blasting here and blasting there and blasting there. And then when it's recovery time, you can come back together. You need to breathe deeply. Don't go for it. Sometimes you feel like holding your breath. Don't. You need that oxygen to go in. The more oxygen that comes in, the more cells are getting the oxygen. And remember, the more aerobic cells that you're going to get. So it's very important to have that little blast of intensity. Time yourself. It's easy. You just count. One, two, three. Not like this. One, two, three, four, five, six. Remember, a second is one and two and three and. Michael and I have been doing it in the creek because we swim every morning. And since the flood, there's more rapids in the little part where we swim. So we get in there and we swim for our life. You just go for it. And at the point where you usually stop because you're just so tight, you just push yourself through it. And you go for that 30 count. And when we stop, we're like this. But it's really nice because it's in the water and the water's hot. Then we allow ourselves recovery. That recovery time, that rest time, is just as important as the intensity. Many people don't get to the intensity and so don't quite get the rest time. And that pain that you feel, the pain that you feel the next day, rejoice. The little microfibers have torn and now they're rebuilding in a stronger way. The metabolic rate of that little energy cycle in the cell has just woken up and it's ready for fuel. Now, I mentioned the other day about this guy that came here that walked across Australia. He said to me by the end of the walk, he could eat five times the food that he was eating at the beginning of the walk because he'd woken up the metabolic rate inside those muscles, and it's a bit like a fire. If this fire was going, the more wood I put in, what's happening? The more fire, the hotter it burns. When you wake up that metabolic rate of your muscle cells, the more fuel you give them, the harder they burn and the stronger they get. I was reading about Dr. McGough recently, and he's a guy that's written a book on this, Science by Exercise. I haven't read the whole book. I've only just started. I only just got the book. Fascinating stuff. He says in there, regarding weight loss, which is what so many Aussies are very interested in, he says 80% is diet. Now, this is the exercise guru. He says 80% is diet. And he shows the importance of dropping these carbohydrates right down, increasing the FPF, fiber, protein, and fat. So you get a fuel that is not going to be stored, that is going to go into that cell to be burnt, into those muscle cells. He says 20% exercise. But when you go to this intensity, you increase the body's ability to actually kick into that protein burning, that fat burning. See, what you're looking for is a release of the human growth hormone. With a release of the human growth hormone, you see, he talks about ancestors and running for your life because there's a tiger after you, or there's a man with a gun after you, or there's a dinosaur after you, whatever the theory. The body starts to think, we've got to get rid of this excess weight. We've got to get these muscles a bit stronger so we can actually run from the tiger a bit better. That's one of the theories. However you put the theory in, it's the same thing. You can change the metabolic rate of your cells to become fat burners, to burn off the excess fat and to strengthen those muscles. Dr. Atkins, he showed in his book that if you're eating adequate protein, you will never lose muscle. And so you see the cycle that the obese, overweight people get into. The more carbs they eat, the more it is stored and the less the muscle is being used. What does the human growth hormone do? The human growth hormone stops burning glucose as fuel and becomes a fat burner. And you can see why, because burning the fat will give more than twice the units of energy that the glucose will give. The human growth hormone also triggers an enzyme to be released that directly goes to fat stores to help break them down so they can be burnt as fuel. The human growth hormone also increases the body's ability to utilize protein. This week we've looked at the importance of protein. We've looked at the fact that every membrane around every cell in your body is 50% protein. We looked at the double-banded helix strand, which is the DNA, and the amino acid bands. We also looked at the ribosome where the new cell is made, and it's brick upon brick upon brick to make the new cell. What are the bricks? Amino acids. Body cannot heal without protein. So number one, it's very important to be eating adequate protein. Number two, it's very important to be mindful of your gastric juices so you've got enough hydrochloric acid to break down the protein. And number three, it's very important that you move that body every day, get that at least 30 seconds going for it, causing a release of the human growth hormone so you can better utilize that protein. That also explains why once the human growth hormone's moving, once those muscle cells have been wakened up, the more fuel you put into that fire, the hotter it burns, the more effective it burns, and the more healing happens in the body. The human growth hormone also increases the circulation of the blood to the skin. No wonder the movie stars pay $1,000 a week for that stuff. You can see why. Wow. Keeps them young. Well, I'm offering it to you cut price today, ladies and gentlemen. Half an hour's exercise a day containing a maintenance of 20 minutes aerobic. And your 30 second going for it will kick you in to that aerobic running. Aerobic and cardio, it's called. Why is it called aerobic? Because it gets more oxygen in, because you start breathing a little deeper. Very important when you're exercising to have that mouth open. So you've got oxygen going in nose and mouth. Now, the other day I said we should be breathing through our nostrils. But when you're exercising, when you're going for that 30 seconds, aerobic, when you've got that human growth hormone type exercise happening, you need both. One lady said, you said we should breathe through our nose, Barbara. I've been exercising, walking up the hills. I have to open my mouth. I said, so do I. We all do. Aren't you glad God gave us two? And when you're really going for it, you need both. Absolutely. That's your aerobic. What's your cardio? Your cardio is referring to the cardiac muscle, which is the heart muscle. And when you start moving, that heart muscle starts pumping a little bit faster. So they're your signs that you're doing the intensity. Your intensity is your aerobic cardio. Dr. McGough is a cardiovascular surgeon, and that's why he started at this theory, to get his heart patients' heart muscle running a little bit faster. But then he found all of these other benefits. Very interesting reading. The proverb says, keep the heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Absolutely. Keep that heart with diligence. How do you keep it with diligence? You make sure you're lowering your carbs, eating the three essentials, and you're moving the body every single day. One lady said to me, do you ever wake in the morning and think I won't go today? I said, no. It's actually not even one of the equations of the morning. When I wake up in the morning, my thought is it raining? Do I need a hat? Is it hot? Do I just wear a t-shirt? 9th of March this morning, first day I wore my leggings. It was a bit cool this morning. That's the only equation in my line. So the human growth hormone, easily accessed, half an hour's exercise a day containing the 20-minute aerobic will cause a release of that human growth hormone. And remember, your 30 seconds, that's the beginning of the maintenance of your cardio. Yes, you have recovery, but that 30 seconds kicks you into aerobic running. Basically, when I mean running, the cell running, your metabolic rate running. When you maintain that 20 minutes aerobic, the human growth hormone is active for 24 hours. Wow. You know what that means? It's forever running. I told you it was a bargain. No matter where I am, I do it. When I was in Fiji early December, early morning along the beach, that was so nice. And then we just ran into barefoot running on the beach, nothing better. And then we dived into the sea at the end. I had about 100 Fijian kids between the age of 40 and about 14 and 35. I remember there was this young Fijian man taking the exercise program and they're walking, and I ran up to him and I said, can we run? He said, yes. And we went for it. He said, because you see, sadly, some of those young Fijian kids are overweight and they can't run. But you know, you just start where you are. Maybe a brisk walk. You just do what you can. And what if the ankles or the knees aren't working? Get an exercise bike. Still doesn't work. Swim. Swimming is excellent exercise. I was in Foster a couple of years ago doing meetings, and we got an apartment by the sea. Have you ever booked an apartment by the sea or with sea views on the internet? Yeah, we had sea views, about 2 foot of it, between the buildings. Anyway, we were one street back. When you read the internet, you think you're right on the beach. Anyway, we walked on the beach every morning. And it's hard to get aerobic there, so I just kept running. You keep doing bursts of running or jump down and do bursts of your push-ups. And there was a sea pool. How I love sea pools. High tide, the sea pool gets a beautiful flush out. So every morning I dived in the sea pool. Do you know what that quick cold does? Now it's July, so I'm in the sea pool 10 seconds at the most. But the sea water in the winter is a lot warmer than the creek water because of the warm currents that come through. So I was only in there about 10 seconds. And I don't know if you've experienced it this week. Please try it if you'd like to. Mention it to Howard, take a little towel, leave it down by the bridge maybe, and at the end of your exercise, dive in. And you'll find when you're coming back, your muscles are energized. We find after we've done our dip in the creek, we can almost run up those hills because that's what that quick goal does. It just energizes those muscles and just whoosh, gets that blood in very quickly. So I'm down by the sea pool, diving in every morning. So good. And there was a lady there. And I saw her there about 3 mornings. She had a wetsuit on. She had a little wetsuit hat on. She had a kickboard. She had flippers. And she would just go backwards and forwards. So one morning, as she was coming near me, I went over near her and I said, "Excuse me, can I ask you a question?" And when I got nearer, I looked at this lady. She was in her 70s. Whoa. I said, "Can I just ask you a couple of questions?" She said, "Sure." I said, "Why are you doing this? Are you doing this for an injury?" She said, "No, this is my morning exercise program." She said, "This works really well for me." Wow. Knees or feet don't work? Swim. Cold? Get a wetsuit. Can't swim? Kickboard and flippers. There's no excuse there, is there? That would have been the best investment she would have made. I said to her, "If everyone in Foster was down here doing this, those medical surgeries would nearly be empty. Casualty would nearly be empty." Is it that simple? It actually is quite simple. Exercise is not negotiable. Exercise is essential. But remember what Dr. McGough says. Diet is 80%. I've got a book in the library by John Gabriel. I don't know if you've ever seen it. There's a picture of him on the front page. He looks like Howard, you know, fit, muscular body. And he's got a pair of pants on and they come out to here. And then inside the book, there's a photograph of him. I think he was 183 kilos. And he was now down to 80 kilos. And the slogan on the book says, "Weight loss without dieting." And what he does is he kicks into this. It kicks into this intensity, and that's what he says. On your morning walk, suddenly jump down and do 30 seconds push-ups. And you'll find that many exercise gurus, weight loss gurus now are kicking in to this called interval training, the training of intensity and rest. And remember, after your 30 seconds intensity, you're not sitting down. You're actually doing something a little bit differently, but you're resting the parts that were just going for it, like climbing a hill or cycling up a hill and then cycling down a hill. They're your recovery times. So you just got to find out what to do, where to do it and how to do it. I'm not near the sea. I don't like swimming in chlorine and my knees and my ankles don't work. Fitball. Fitballs are fantastic. Just one ball only takes up a small room. And you know, if you're in a high-rise building and it's snowing outside, you can use Fitball. But when you do your Fitball, make sure you open the windows because you're going to need some oxygen, some fresh air. That's why we need plants in the house. And you can get quite a workout with your Fitball. Pilates, one of those, I can't get down the ground. Fitball, that was the only thing we could do with one lady who was about 120 kilo. We got her a Fitball. And we put her near the stairs and she held on to the banister because at first she couldn't even sit on it. When you sit on a Fitball, your core is working really hard, otherwise you'll fall off the Fitball. And your abs start to work really hard. And you can get quite aerobic, quite intensity by doing the Fitball. So not negotiable subject, you just got to find out what to do and how to do it. It's good to have a few options for if it is hailing or snowing or whatever, where you can do a Pilates workout. Pilates is great because many people in Australia have sore backs, don't they? Back problems. And you notice that the biggest bone in the body is the femur. Biggest muscle mass in the body is the quads. And do you know why that is? Because we should bend and lift right here. And the only time we don't bend and lift there is when we bend like that. When we bend like that, we're not putting any strain on there. All the strain goes here. But if you keep that back straight, all the strain goes here in the quads and in the femur. And that's why they're so strong, because they're supposed to take the weight and the strain. Many people's backs bend like that instead of like that, because they sit on lounge chairs like this. So be mindful of your posture. When you get those abs strong, they will automatically pull in to line that spine, so it'll be a lot easier. Now I can bend down with my back straight much more than I used to be able to, because I do it every day, little by little. When I was in the Bronx in 04, There was this 70-year-old Jamaican man weeding round the... Where do you get weeds in the Bronx? Well, there's about an inch between the telegraph pole and the cement sometimes. Not much. He was bending down weeding. His legs were straight. His back was perfectly straight and he's weeding. Wow, there's not many people can do that. It's nothing to do with age. It's nothing to do with genetics. And of course, it's nothing to do with money. It's just time. It's just what you put into your body. So let's have a look at exercise. It's got to have frequency, intensity, and the last one is duration. And the duration, of course, takes into consideration not just doing your 30 seconds and then stopping, but you keep running the human body, and the recovery happens by changing the different muscles that you're using. See, when you're swimming, it could be breaststroke one lap, it could be freestyle another, it could be backstroke another. So alternating the different parts of the body that you're using, but you're actually maintaining that aerobic. You just flip from one exercise to the other. So part of your body that you've just worked to its absolute limit, then you kick over and give it a rest. Now what this Japanese trainer found, that when his girls exercise like this, then when they went for a big long endurance skate, they had more energy to do it. They had more ability to do it because all week they were doing this interval training. It's quite simple, isn't it? And when you know those keys, then you're able to use it. We had a girl come here and she told me that one day she was going to a basketball. She's about 15 when this happened. She was in a hot car, cold morning, and all wrapped up in blankets, got to the basketball court, jumped out, what in? Little skirt, shoes and socks, and she went straight into it and she snapped her Achilles tendon. That's why it's very important with your half-hour exercise that you have at least a 3 to 5 minute warm-up. Very important to do that before you shock those. You're going to shock your muscles, but you've got to do a little bit of a warm-up so they know something's coming. And you want that intensity, but you can't go straight into that intensity. You've got to have at least a 3 to 5 minute warm-up. And I think Howard does that quite well with you, doesn't he? We had another guy do our program and he was a international soccer competition soccer player when he was young. He was 40 when he came. He said at the age of 26, he noticed that his foot started dragging one day. It was just dragging behind him. And I mean, this is his life. So he went to the doctor and he said, "My foot." And the doctor says, "What do you do?" He says, "I'm an international competition soccer player. I need that foot." The doctor looked at him and he said, "When do you play the game the hardest?" He said, "Well, Saturday afternoon at the game." He said, "All right. Do you push yourself to the absolute limit of human endurance?" And the guy said, "Well, of course we do. We want to win the game." He said, "Is it the one time of the week where you demand from your body the absolute limits of human endurance?" And the guy said, "Well, of course." And the doctor said, "And what do you do after the game?" The guy looked at him. He said, "What do you do? What do you do to your body after the game? Do you take it home and give it a well-earned rest?" And of course, we all know what happens Saturday night, don't we? They go out and party. He said, "Nah, you take your body out after you've pushed it to the absolute limit and you beat it up, don't you?" The guy looked down. Doctor said, "No wonder your foot won't work." And just started writing something. And the guy said, "Well, what'll I do?" He said, "Oh, well, I could inject some cortisone in, might bring it back to life." The guy's beside himself. He said, "Well, what about a personal trainer?" And the doc said, "Oh, yeah, personal trainer might bring it back to life. I'll refer you to a friend of mine." He went to the personal trainer. Personal trainer did exactly the same thing. "And what do you do Saturday afternoon? And what do you do Saturday night?" And the guy's getting a little bit sick of this now. He says, okay, yeah, that's what we do. But he said, what will I do now? The personal trainer said, swim 40 laps a day, you might save it. And he just walked away. He did. He said, I saved my foot. It was very good advice, because that foot, it needed a little bit of rest. You know, when someone's got an injury, there needs to be times of rest and times of working it, because you've got to get that blood into it. And that's why you're the guide. If it's a sickening pain, don't do it. If it's a pain of, give me a rest soon, you can do it. I think only you know your pain. We all know the sickening pain of, don't even think about that. And we all know the pain of, it's like when the massage therapist massages those rock gardens in your shoulders. It's like, oh, that's so painful, but please don't stop. It's a, you know, it's that good pain. And he saved his foot. You see, swimming was excellent advice, because he was really working out. He had to get that human growth hormone released by the intensity, but he could not do any intensity on that foot. At first, the poor old foot sort of gave a little flip every now and then, but after about a week, the foot started to move a little bit. After another week, the foot started to kick. I think it took about 3 weeks, and that foot was as strong. Wow. When you have an injury, don't cradle it. Don't put it in the nursery. Obviously, it can't quite do what the others can do, but you must move it. You look at any kid that's had a broken bone and got plaster on, and the doctor says you can't walk for 6 weeks. Have a look at the kid at 3 weeks. They're running around the place, dragging that plaster behind them, and notice they recover so much quicker. And I tell you what, if it hurts, they won't do it. And that's the body's sign. Do you know pain's your friend? Pain is there to tell you, don't do that. Or please do that, yeah? It's like when your muscles get very sore on the morning walk, it's the lactic acid. What do? You stop, you look at the view. Maybe you'll start working out the top part of your body while you're resting the sore part. And when the pain goes, keep walking. Because the more oxygen you'll get into your body, the less lactic acid that you will get. So it's very important to keep moving that body. There's the story of, and a guy told me this story. He said, I broke my tibia and my fibula. He said, I was in hospital for 3 months. I said, 3 months? He said, well, the pin and plate didn't quite take, so they actually had to do it again. He said, I came out of that hospital the fittest I've ever been. I said, excuse me? Fittest? Sitting in bed for 3 months? He said, I sat up my whole bed like a gym. He said, every hour, I'm working out, working out. It was probably like walking 7 hours a day. What a great idea. I think if he hadn't been doing that, he might have been in that hospital 5 months. He couldn't work the leg, but he could work every other part of the body, get that blood working at a better rate, which meant more blood was going into that leg. You'll find most physiotherapists, they're getting people up within a few hours sometimes of their operation. And some people think that's not right. It actually is right. Yes, they do them to get them home quicker so they can have the bed for someone else, but they can only get them home if the person's actually well enough to go. And what gets them well enough to go? Getting them moving as soon as possible. You know, 50 years ago, if a woman had a baby, she couldn't get out of bed for a week. Now, they get the woman moving quickly. I had a few home births. You know, after you have your home birth, you can actually get up and tend your little toddler. You know, you've heard stories of the Chinese squatting in the fields, planting the rice. Oh, I better go behind a tree. Baby's born. Baby gets wrapped up. You know, we hear these stories. Well, I've met a few people that have seen it. Do you know what one of the things is? That woman is active right up until she gives birth to her baby. It's not a sickness. I say to people, it's a physical event. You've got to start training. I say to women, as soon as you fall pregnant, you've got to go into training. How many women sit back? I've got a craving for ice cream. I've got a craving for chocolate. And they get bigger. And then when the baby comes out, they've got stretch marks all over them because they just got so big. I remember one of my babies, he was an 8.5 pound baby. I went in and the lady said, are you sure you're ready? Are you sure you're... I said, yeah, I'm 9 months and I gave birth to an eight and a half pound baby, because there was just no excess weight on. There's no need for that excess weight. You got to go into training. A woman should be her fittest as she goes into labour. And I had the great privilege of actually delivering my fifth baby. They thought I had ages to go and everyone left me. So I started marching around the room and I felt the urge and I was able to deliver my baby myself. What a beautiful thing to actually take out of your body a baby. How many women don't have that privilege? You've got to be very fit. You've got to get ready for this physical exertion. It's called labour and it's hard work. It's hard work. And if you're fit and able to do it, you won't get women fearing childbirth. None of my girls feared childbirth. They all had home births and delivered their babies naturally because they'd never heard any scary stories. Because they grew up in a home where birth was spoken about as a very natural thing, that the woman can do it easily. The attendant should be just there to be called upon if needed to be. It is not a sickness. We had an organic farmer and his wife do our program a couple of years ago. There's nothing wrong with this couple. They're in their 60s. Nothing wrong. I could not find any ailment in this couple. They said to me, we've been organic for 30 years. They have an organic dairy farm. They said, but everything we eat is organic. And the farmer said to me, do you know I'm never called out to a cow in distress at childbirth now? Wow. He says, before we went organic, once a fortnight I'd be called out to a cow in distress giving birth to her baby. He said, never now. Isn't that interesting? Every cell in the body is so well nourished, it works well. And what a sickness industry almost is surrounding birth today. Yeah? And yet if the woman's body's strong, healthy, well nourished, birth should happen with ease. Tomorrow we're going to talk about what happens between the ears, and I'm afraid many women fear childbirth, so that's the fear thing. But you know, fear and faith are polar opposites. When a woman believes that she will be able to deliver her baby and the baby will be healthy, that goes a long way to producing that. I remember there was one book written, Childbirth Without Pain, and it was this guy, Grantley Dick Reed, his name was, and he was an English physician in about the 40s, and he used to watch women scream all through the childbirth. And then one day he was called to a woman who was giving birth to a baby in one of the little homes in the slums. He went down there, he went into the room, it was dark, and he said there was a real peacefulness in the room, and there was the woman going through labour, breathing through every contraction in control, and he decided to just stand back. He thought, this woman doesn't need me, but I'm going to watch. And as the breathing got heavier, he knew that the contractions were getting stronger and she would just relax and breathe deeply between every contraction. He knew when she went into contraction, he could knew it by the way she was breathing. She'd breathe up to the intensity and breathe down. And then her breathing changed and guttural sounds began, and he knew the baby was being born. So he went over closer and just helped her a little to deliver the baby. He went home that night puzzled. He thought, why did this woman just birth her baby naturally with no screaming, no terror? And he just thought of the women in hospital who just scream and one help was such a marked difference. And he went right in to what happens in the stomach wall. See, we have muscles that are involuntary and muscles that are voluntary. And in labour, the involuntary muscles tighten with every contraction, pulling that cervix up. And when a woman is fearsome, her voluntary muscles tighten against the tightening of the involuntary muscles, and there's the intense pain. Isn't that interesting? So he wrote a book, Childbirth Without Pain, by Grantley Dick Reed. And again, where did it all start? Just between the ears. It's the way that the woman... way that the woman saw it. And the reason the Chinese women give birth to their babies out in the field, I'm sure they go home and have a little rest, is because they have no fear, because they've not known any fear in childbirth. Tomorrow we're going to spend a whole lecture on what happens between the ears. But one of the best ways to get that brain working a little bit better is to exercise. Exercise is vital. It's the very condition of life. More people rust out than wear out. This amazing human body is different to any other machinery. The more you work it, the stronger it gets, the more efficient it gets, and the stronger that heart gets, and the more efficient that heart beats. It's almost like your bank account. You put a little bit in your bank account every day, within a year or 2 or 5 years, you got a nice sum of money. It's exactly the same with exercise. You put a little bit in every day by your morning exercise, you have a look in a year or two, and you'll be amazed at how strong your body is. I just do half-hour exercise a day, containing always approximately 20-minute aerobic. I don't consider that I am peak fitness, but I would consider that I was average fitness. And I did a walk one day up a huge mountain, hour and a half walking like this. And in the team we had, one of the guys was about 35, and he had all those little machines monitoring your heart rate and your breathing. And we got 3/4 of the way up, and he's monitoring it, and he said, "Let me have a look at yours." And he looked at mine and he went, "You're one fit woman." I was actually better than him, and he was 35. You see, it's just such a simple thing. When your body's fit and running well, it's like you're driving a Rolls-Royce of a body. How nice to live in a body that works. It's got nothing to do with age. It's got nothing to do with genetics. It's all, and that's the same with your bank account. It's got nothing to do with age or genetics, does it? It's purely what you put into it. It's exactly the same with the fitness of the human body. You put a little bit in every day. When a crisis comes, if I've got a bank account, I've got something to fall back on. When a crisis comes, whether it be physically, mentally, spiritually or emotionally, if your body is fit, you've got a bank account there. And I think one of the reasons so many Aussies are coming down with mental illness is they've forgotten square one, which is exercise. Because not only does the blood improve to every part of the body, it improves into the brain, as my initial story showed you. The only time you'll have trouble with exercise, if you try to exercise in a body that is not well hydrated and not well mineralized. I'm going to give everyone a break now, and after the lecture, we're going to have a look at those two vital subjects, water and salt.